Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for attending today's CEO Office Hours. It's part of our virtual learning series, connecting you with the best minds in healthcare and beyond. We're so excited that you've chosen to join us today. I also want to thank you for all of the questions that you sent in as part of your registration process. I think it'd be fair to say there was a couple of themes that emerged in those questions. And as what usually happens, right, is that sometimes our questions really reflect the things that we are struggling with the most. But I bet you have some things that you're very proud of, some things that you've tried that have worked well. And I'd like to invite you to use the chat function today to share with your colleagues some of your innovations, some of your bright ideas, so that we can create, you know, other opportunities for self-help and learning today. But you're really here to hear some one of our experts, aren't you? And in today's session, talent management in the COVID-19 era, we will be discussing workplace culture, trends in employee turnover, empowering remote workers, and the future of HR. And we're so very happy that joining us today is a sought-after voice on all matters affecting work, workers, and the workplace, a global leader on the future of employment, culture, and leadership. It is really my privilege to introduce Johnny C. Taylor, who is the president and CEO of SHRM, the Society for Human Resource Management. He's a visionary who is advancing HR globally. Under his leadership, SHRM, the world's largest HR professional association, has grown to a record 300,000 plus members in 65 countries who impact the lives of 115 million workers every day. Johnny, I'm sorry that we couldn't meet each other personally earlier this year in Austin, but I want to thank you for joining us today. We hope that you and your family are healthy and well during these challenging times, and we're all looking forward to hearing more from you. So Johnny, turn it over to you.
Well, thank you so much, Chuck, and to all of you. Yeah, I really was looking forward to my trip to Austin, by the way. It's one of my favorite cities in America, and but, you know, COVID had other plans for us. So fortunately, we have to, or unfortunately, depending upon how you look at it, it won. And so we are now joining each other via technology. Thank you all to everyone participating. And Chuck, thank you again for inviting me. You know, I want to start, I want to just spend, 5-10 minutes kind of talking about high level what each of you as CEOs and other members of the C-suite have to be experiencing right now. And we're hearing it from for-profit, nonprofit, government, leaders everywhere. There are some common themes. So I'm gonna talk 10 minutes or so and then really open the floor to questions, because Chuck, I understand you have quite a bit of work for me to do today. But listen, I think the one thing we can all agree upon is there's true leadership fatigue. I'm tired. I said this to my board. We just recently had our board meeting about 2 weekends ago. And I said to them, I said, you know, in all of my years of practice and in work, I'm still thinking like I'm an HR practitioner, but I have never ever worked this hard. I really haven't. And it's not just because I'm the CEO of the world's largest HR association and this impacted people's lives so much, but it's because we kind of have, everything has turned to us. In the past, you've been responsible for hitting the numbers and delivering on the programs or the services that you're supposed to offer, but everything turned on you. The employees needed you more, and not just for workplace culture, but just for their lives, their livelihoods and their lives, by the way, because everyone was focused and all of us have had to focus on safety, so people's health in the workplace. But we also had to think about their livelihoods, because we all had to, unfortunately, deal with furloughs and layoffs and the perception or the fear of furloughs and layoffs coming into play. So we have been social worker, we've been banker, we have been psychologist, you name it, while at the same time, you're being expected to run your business. Right? And because we're all in the nonprofit space, we also have this mission thing. And especially for you all in behavioral health, one thing that that really has become clear to the entire world, not just this country, is the importance of mental health. See, when we've talked about wellness in the past, it's really been, you know, gym memberships and, you know, what are those things that you wear on your wrist, those little bands that measure how many steps you take and all of that. To be fair, we weren't really focused on mental and emotional health. And now we're seeing that behavioral health matters in some ways more than a physical health issue, because it can lead to real physical manifestations in terms of health problems. So we're having to be everything. And I can tell you, you are not alone. I talked just recently with a group of Fortune 500 CEOs about what are we all confronting. And there was universal agreement. I'm just tired. I'm tired of it, and I don't want anyone to take this the right way, wrong way, which is why I'm glad we're talking just amongst us. But, you know, we're now where you used to have quarterly meetings with your employees, and that was considered like a big deal and best in class. Well, now people are expecting you to have these meetings every 2 weeks, and in some instances, once a week. Just the pressure of keeping your employees aware of what's going on when, frankly, it's kind of murky. You don't even know. And, you know, add to it. So you've got COVID, you've got racial unrest and everything that flowed from that. You have a politically divided electorate in a way that we've never seen before. And when we thought it would all be over on November 3rd, it kind of isn't, and it's still going. There's this combination of things that have happened at once. And I don't think, at least in my 20 plus years of practice, I've never seen it all happen, like all of these things hit at once. And then the economic pressure that flows from all of that, right? This is a really tough time to be in leadership. My mother would always say, be careful what you pray for. Well, all of us who longed to be in that corner office or in one of the C-suite offices now really have to be looking back at December 1st and looking at the first 11 months of this year and saying, I'm exhausted. And it's okay to acknowledge that. So that's something I wanted to start with, is you are not alone if you're feeling physically and mentally fatigued, because we all are. The demands of leadership are at a level that we frankly have never before seen. I mean, they just haven't with any of those four things. We talked about economic, racial unrest, COVID, all of any one of those we can handle, and maybe two, but all four at one time is really worn down on you. So I hope that all of us, you know, the cobbler's kids have no shoes, we've got to make sure that we're taking care of ourselves as leaders, because 2021, we already are seeing, is going to bring COVID, will still be with us at least until first half of the year at a minimum. And so a lot will flow from that. So that's that. But I'm talking to a group of my colleagues, nonprofit CEOs and C-suite members. And I want to tell you, just before we get into the question, there are three things that are really top of mind right now. And at least for me, and it's what we're hearing all over the HR world. Number one, it is the importance of culture. You cannot, in the past, we've all talked about, and it's kind of a soft word in HR speak, you know, what's your culture? And historically it was, especially, you know, following the lead of Silicon Valley, do you have ping pong tables and lunch and, you know, all of that kind of stuff. And that was kind of how we determined who were the cultural leaders. Well, now it's far more nuanced. There's now an expectation that you get culture right, which means there's some real pressure, because your culture, this notion that there's a good culture and a bad culture, now I'm going to accept out illegal and unethical cultures, put that aside, those are bad. But generally speaking, there is no good or bad culture. It's your culture. And you've got to be really darn clear about that, because increasingly employees are going to hold you accountable. The people are going to leave other jobs and or turn down other opportunities to come work with and for you. And if they get there and what you sold them, your employer brand, your cultural statements that are on all of the walls, the guiding principles and values, if there is a disconnect, they will hold you accountable. And because of social media and everything, there is literally no way for them not to be able to tell the story about what it means to really work in at your organization. And that's why that's really my best working definition of culture. It is how things really work, what it really means to work within an organization. That's the culture. And so we in leadership have to be very, very clear, very, very intentional, not say I am what another organization is. I am what we are. And there needs to be alignment with all of your C-suite. And then don't waver. You can't be what every other company is. You can only be you. Number two, one of the issues that we are all seeing, and you may not even yourself realize part of our challenge from an employee-based standpoint is the multi-generational workforce. You know, for the first time in our lifetimes, frankly, and many say in history, we have five generations in the workplace at once. And trying to manage all of the expectations, the norms, it's a handful in and of itself. It's a type of diversity. When we talk about diversity, we usually think, you know, race and gender and those national origin and religion and those sorts of things. But this diversity of age in the workplace is real. And while we joke about those millennials or those Generation Z or those baby boomers, there's something to be said for, while we're generalizing, there are some characteristics that come with the various generations. And when you put them all in the workplace at one time and try to come up with a benefit plan that makes them all happy, good luck, because your millennials are they want a benefit plan that hopefully pays off their student loans, and your, you know, older workers are trying to figure out how to prepare for retirement. And it's just, it's all over the place. And it's not just benefits related, by the way, it's literally how they respond to management directives. And yes, I use that word because, believe it or not, it is still okay to give directives as a leader. There are expectations that you lead and that in doing so people follow. And so there's this real dynamic at play that undergirds a lot of what's happening in the workplace today, which is managing an intergenerational, multi-generational workforce. It's real, and we should come to grips with what that means. The third area that I know we're all talking about is DE&I. The diversity, and frankly, we've now included equity. That was not always a letter in the acronym. It was D&I or just diversity, but more and more people are adding the equity. I'll talk a little bit more about that. But how do you manage through that? How do you do it in a responsible way that doesn't alienate, vilify one group over the other, and prevent people from engaging in the very behavior that they complain about, except now they're in control, or they're group is in control, is so it's really something that we are all trying to manage, and we're not protected from it just because we're a nonprofit. There's a real issue with trying to figure out how to provide an environment that respects, embraces diversity, equity, and inclusion without alienating others and actually doing long-term more harm than good. And the final topic that I know everyone wants to talk about, and we will, is managing remote workers. Let me tell you, I go to great lengths to make this clear. It's easy to believe that everyone's working remotely. Right? That's what the headlines tell us. That's what, you know, everywhere you read, everyone's is working remotely. Well, that ignores fact. The fact of the matter is 45 to arguably 60% of the American workforce has been considered essential, which means they had to go into a workplace. If not full-time, 3 days out of five or 2 out of 5 days. Many of these roles simply cannot be done fully remotely. And I'm reminded of a situation recently. I was at a dinner party and I had a teacher, a classroom, public school classroom teacher, really complaining about people suggesting that they should reopen schools. And she was saying, you know, it's really unfair for you all to expect us to put our lives at risk. Well, she was going on, and then all of a sudden, another woman in the room who works at Walmart and happened to be working at a Walmart in this teacher's neighborhood said, well, I think that's really funny of you. You ignore the fact that I went to work every day. In fact, you've come through my line and I put myself at risk to make sure that you get what you want. We ignore that, you know, while you can order things remote, you know, online, someone has to deliver it to your door, you know? So that FedEx, that USPS, that UPS person has to come to work every day. And many of your employees, in fact, have to deliver in person, right? And while technology is our friend, we can't ignore that, you know, notwithstanding all of the headlines, a lot of people continue to show up to a workplace, and we have to be sensitive to making sure that they are safe and feel valued, and that they don't feel like that what they're doing is outdated, because of course everyone's working remotely, and you must, you know, there's the white collar, the professionals, and then there's those blue collar people like you all who have to show up. We're really beginning to see a rift in the workplace, because we're speaking in big generalizations and offending groups of people. So those are the four things I want to set up and then open the floor for your questions so that I can respond to. But all of them are really important, and they're trending in the SHRM world. We have 300,000 members, as Chuck pointed out, in 165 countries, and they're in all industries. So we don't just speak to one industry. We don't just talk to for-profit HR leaders or business leaders. We talk to everyone, and we're gathering data. So I'll stop with that, Chuck, and turn it over for questions.
Well, thanks so much, Johnny. You know, I think one of the questions actually follows up on the last point that you're making. For a lot of our member agencies, they have folks that have been, that come in all the time, or they're out on the street doing outreach, but they do have some staff that are working remotely. And I know one of the questions that's come in quite a bit is feeling like, you know, how do you have equity within the organization when there are some folks working from home and others that aren't? And I'm sure we're not the only ones dealing with those kind of questions.
Well, so that I love the word equity. I go to great lengths to explain to my staff there's equality and there's equity. And equality in the sense of, you know, I don't pretend that everyone who works here is equal. We actually may pay a premium to people who have to show up every day and come into a workplace. There's this crazy, I call it crazy because it's so out of the box thinking. Deutsche Bank has a researcher who suggested that there be a 5% tax on people who are allowed to work remotely. And they will put it to actually provide a premium to people who actually have to show up to work. Because as this person argues, you save money working at home. Now I can make the other argument as well, but they make the argument that, you know, no dry cleaning bill, your lunch bill is cheaper because you can buy groceries. There are a lot of arguments to be made for the case that there is at least a 5% value that can be truly attributed to people who work remotely, and therefore a cost to people who have to show up and go to work every day. And so maybe call it battle pay, call it whatever you want, but trying to work that out. What I say is we don't speak in terms of equality, because, and please, no one take this missing, you know, there's an equal employment opportunity commission, there's all of that stuff. Equality as a concept, there's no one disagreeing with, but equity is perhaps the better term, because I can have two employees in the who work with us, one who has the benefit of staying home and working remotely, still working hard. I'm not suggesting that working remotely is easy. It comes with some downsides as well, but that person who has come to work, that we treat them equitably, not equally. And we have, and the law allows you to do that, by the way, as long as you can explain why there is a non-discriminatory, illegal discriminatory, that is, basis for paying person X who does the exact same job differently from person Y, you can do that. And so we are more and more thinking about how do we reward people who must assume some risk in coming to work physically every day, particularly if it means interacting with the public. You can do that. The law allows it. And more we're saying that is an equitable way to address this. Again, it's not about equal. It's about equity.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense. I noticed, the predominant question that we received from people who signed up for today's webinar was folks really struggling with how to engage and motivate remote workers. And I don't know that there's any magic sauce, but if anybody has any ideas, I know it's you.
And I don't, but no. But let me tell you, so fascinating, and I'm sure you've seen this, but all of our research tells us that from March until about late May, early June, productivity went through the roof. and people were engaged and they were everything. And I think it's because all of us believed somehow that if we shut the country down essentially for 21 days, 30 days, 45 days, we'd be all past this. I don't know about you, but I would bet a check in March that we would not be here right now.
Like, oh, absolutely. I thought we'd be back in the office in June.
That's right. Well, particularly that's what we were told. Like, you got to shut the place down for 14, 21 days, whatever. And so here we are. But the most important point is we saw productivity going through the roof, partly because it was perceived to be short term. Okay. Secondly, because at least in the early period, the first 10, 12 weeks, everything else was shut down. So there was nowhere else to go. Literally, you could go to the grocery store or not, you know, just restaurants were shut down in the beginning. And then things opened up. So now we all have, you know, you're at home and your employee can actually, I can't tell you the number of times I've called someone who's working remotely and they'll call me and say, oh, I'm at the store. Let me, you know, or I can hear the background noise from the store that they're shopping in. I'm like, wait a minute, that's not working remotely. You're available, but you're not working. You would be in the office otherwise. So we are seeing as a result, productivity go the other way. And I mean, it's pronounced. Some of it, even for your best, most diligent people, there's a fatigue that's also set. And I talk about leadership fatigue. Yeah. There's also just employees are tired. If you're like me, there's a Zoom call after Zoom call after Zoom call, and you're just exhausted. You're over it. And it's gotten old. Also, there's a sense of isolation, particularly, and our research tells us that employees who don't have children and who are not married, so this hits in a very hard way older workers and very young workers. You got a college graduate who moved to a city and started working, doesn't really know anyone. And even if they know people, their friends are coming out, aren't coming together and aggregating for happy hour and those things, it's lonely. And at some point, you all being in behavioral health, you understand that takes its toll on the individual's overall sense of well-being. So we're starting to see the effects, the negative effects of this. Now, you asked me, what should you do? So we're doing a couple of things. I use the term be extra. You know, my 10-year-old says that to me all the time. Oh, daddy, you're so extra. And well, in our business, we actually have to be extra. And so we're doing a couple of things to keep them engaged. On all Zoom calls, there is a requirement at SHRM, and increasingly a lot of companies are saying, you've got to turn your screen on. Like, I've got to see your camera. It's not okay for me to just hear your voice. There are all sorts of reasons why, I don't have to tell you all, but we're able to see if an employee is in stress, under stress. We're able to see domestic violence, which is going up and through the roof. We're able to see and detect an employee's overall well-being. That's one thing that you can do simply, tactically, is to require people to put on clothes, get dressed, and get in the front of a screen. They don't have to fully dress up as if going to work. I mean, I was just recently given an award and it was a black tie event. It's kind of odd because people actually put on a black tie. But whatever, it wasn't me, right? But I did put on a suit. That's number one. Number two, and is that you've got to, and I've asked HR, share with me specific instances of milestone events for people, their birthday, wedding anniversaries, anything that's really happening, you've got to be extra. Call the person, send a bottle of, you know, champagne or whatever to their homes, or send DoorDash, give them lunch one day randomly. These random acts of kindness that keep your employees engaged with you will also help with sort of the isolation, depression. Our recent research tells us that 25%, one in four employees, because we polled employees, not HR professionals, but employees and workers, 25% of them said they feel hopeless, down, and depressed often. Not random, I mean, but often. So that's a sign that this is wearing down, and you can do that. The third thing is to kind of, you know, getting back to something someone said earlier, consider doing special things for the employees. You know, have a day where you celebrate people who are working remotely, because it does come with its stress, right? I'm not suggesting that it's, you know, a great life, because people who need people, right? But call them out and do little things for them, celebrate them. It's low-hanging fruit, but these things really, really matter. Around the holiday season, I can tell you now, it's bad enough that you're forced to stay at home, but you know, given what COVID is doing in various cities, we're even telling people and have told people not to meet locally with your family. So forget getting on an airplane. You can't convene those 20 people for the turkey dinner or whatever that you were planning to have. And so we now come in loco parentis, kind of like we have to step in as employers and be more parent-like. So long answer, at the end of the day, not a lot. We've literally tried everything, sending those nice little things that you can do, but this is painful.
Yeah. You talked earlier about how divided the country is right now, kind of politically. I'm just got to imagine this plays out even when it comes to things like COVID quarantines or other protocols. And, or I'm thinking ahead to vaccination and, you know, what kind of role can HR and CEOs play when navigating some of these differences of opinion?
Well, let me tell you, that's going to become, you know, I'll address momentarily the political issue, because this divide, I mean, not only did it not end on November 3rd, but then you remember you've got the Senate, the Georgia Senate, the Senate whole is in limbo as well. And you're going to have a pretty ugly, for all of those Senate confirmed cabinet roles, that's going to be pretty contentious, because the politicians, and it's an interesting lot, and if any of you all are out there, I'm sorry I'm going to say this, but they're all playing for the next election. So it's not 2024, it's 2022, right? They're already gearing up for that. So I don't think the political stuff goes away. Let's put that on the table. I think the next big battle is going to be, do you mandate COVID vaccinations? And in fact, I just did an interview with NPR that I guess it was Monday, and we talked about that. And there is just going to be really, what of the employees who are going to say, I'll come back if you mandate COVID testing. And then you have some employees who say, well, I don't need you mandating anything. You don't mandate the flu unless you're in a hospital and education setting. There are a few such situations or work settings where people have traditionally mandated it. But what about that? And if one person, and we know this, doesn't take it, is not vaccinated, then what? And then you have questions over, and what if people are vaccinated and under your mandate and they become ill? And so this is just going to be pretty ugly. I already saw just now that a bipartisan group of US senators have proposed a $910 billion or so stimulus plan, but it included in that is protection for employers against litigation coming out of COVID and the COVID vaccination program. So this is going to be a real pull, and we are going to have to get outside of our personal beliefs. And I used to like to say, listen to the scientists, but hell, there are scientists on both sides of this now, legitimate scientists who agree and disagree. So I don't know what's going to come of it, but it is going to be their issue. What can we as CEOs and HR leaders do? We've got to literally start messaging now where we think we're going to go. So I've said to our employees, while I'm not ready to make an absolute decision, I think it is my job as a CEO to protect the workers in the workplace. And, you know, and so I'm hinting very strongly that we are going to, we're going to require the vaccine. Now, it's a debate and there are a whole bunch of factors, so I'm not signing my name up for it, but I can tell you, I've talked to a lot of employers who've said, if I don't, I reopen the day 10 or 12 people get this, I'm shut down. It's going to negatively impact my business, my business reputation, everything else. And so I'm going to mandate it. And we're going to see, I don't know that we'll get to the point of majority of employers, but what you've got to do is start now messaging in your own way, not a commitment necessarily, unless you've already made up your mind. In the same NPR piece that I was engaged in this week, there is a CEO who said point blank, I am telling you now, we will mandate it, full stop. You make whatever decision you want, but you got to start messaging now where you're going to come down. Because, and then how long are you going to require people wear masks? You know, if the vaccine is widely available and is, we're seeing 90%+ effectiveness rates, you know, are you going to mandate, can people wear masks if they've taken the vaccine? I mean, there are just so many factors here. So get ready. The first quarter of next year I predict will be as difficult as the last three quarters of this year. And so that can't make any of us feel good, but you're earning your keep.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you raise another huge issue, which is one that has perplexed my ELT quite a bit is, you know, what's as difficult as it is managing remote workers, the idea of having people come back to the office and thinking about the protocols and the risk, and then you have people who aren't comfortable. It seems to me like, you know, there's still so many things to try to navigate as a leader of an organization right now.
Well, there are. And, you know, I'm going to give you two examples. So there was early on in this process, Jack Dorsey, CEO of Square and Twitter and founder of. So he says, early on, we're now going to work remotely forever. He makes that commitment. A couple of weeks back, the CEO, and his name escapes me, but the CEO of Netflix says the second a vaccine is available, and in fact, I think his quote is 12 seconds after a vaccine is available, people are coming back to work at Netflix or they won't come back to work. And so you're seeing these very, very different positions. And the fact of the matter is none of them are wrong. It gets back to that first thing that I said, it's culture. You and your ELT are going to have to sit in a room and say, the guy from Netflix, Reed Hastings, that's what he said. He made the statement that like, we are a creative, innovative bunch, and we do that in person far better than we do remotely. We just can't replicate it. He's decided that is core to their culture, core to their business, and that's what they're going to do. Now, he has a responsibility to provide as safe, and we have to be very careful as CEOs. I've never guaranteed safety. People can come to work and, you know, God forbid, be killed in a workplace violence issue. I mean, there's no such thing as guaranteeing safety. So even that matter, that language matters. Saying to your employees, I'm gonna provide a reasonably safe place for you to come to work and dealing with the things that we know and doing our best to deal with as much as we don't know, but you just gotta decide. So in short, Chuck, you and all of the CEOs and CHROs and others on this phone, this is a time where you're gonna have to lean into what your culture is, and you're gonna have to make a decision. And there is no right or wrong, but you're gonna have to say it. More and more, we're gonna see hybrid cultures. Now, I gotta say this because I'm sure there's some lawyer or someone out there saying, yeah, but Johnny, there are religious exceptions. There are health considerations. There are child care considerations. That goes back to equity. What is the equitable answer? Not necessarily the equal. Treating everyone equally is like impossible to do. But I do think that this is the point when each of us has to ask ourselves, what's our bias? And we all have them, by the way, very consciously when it comes to, do you want people working? Do you want in the workplace? Do you want them working at home? Or do you want a hybrid? And how are you gonna make this all work?
Yeah, well, you know, you anticipated some of the questions that people have asked about religious and other exemptions. So it's complicated.
Let me just, if I can, just because the religious one, I was on last 2 weeks ago, I met with the vice chair of the EEOC, Sunderland, and at the end of that same week, I met him, interestingly, in person at the EEOC's, the commission's offices, and then I met with Commissioner Samuels, both of them having, we now have a full EEOC, by the way, and enough to vote, at least. And so we were sitting down talking about how do you manage through that? Because what we know is the standard for religious accommodation has always been sincerely held beliefs. And so that's hard. And is there a reasonable accommodation? And is it undue? These are not, this is where HR people, really good HR people, are going to have to be on their game, because these are specific, case-specific circumstances. If you really suggest, I mean, anyone can tomorrow say, well, I have a religious prohibition that says I can't wear masks. And we're seeing that now, by the way, in the workplace now, people who have people back in the workplace, people are saying, legitimately, I can't wear them. And you now have to make a call. That's where you've got to get ahead of it, because you can expect. The other thing as we leave this is what we're hearing from the work from home. And this is what I think all of us would admit amongst CEOs and C-suite leaders. A lot of employees have come to like this.
Oh, yes.
Right? And so when it's time to come back, it's not that I've already had a few say to me, well, I've proven for 8 months that I can work remotely. So, you know, I don't have to have a religious reason. I've just proven that I can. So therefore I will. And again, I think your default has to be what your culture is. And when employees said to a CEO, and I'll protect the CEO's identity, you know, well, you know, at company X, they've allowed people who have comparable jobs to work remotely. And the CEO says, well, I guess you're going to apply for a position at company X. And he wasn't intended to be glib, but his point was like, company X does a lot of things we don't do, and we do a lot of things they don't do. So you've got to take the entire employment experience as a whole and decide where you want to work. And you're not a bad person for wanting this, and I'm not a bad leader for wanting this. You know, again, you carve out all of the stuff where you, for all of the religious reasons and people who are in specific at-risk groups, age-related, pre-existing health conditions, et cetera. I'm not talking about that, but I'm talking about, we know now that you have a significant group of people who just like doing this and are now going to demand it. And you've got to figure out how you manage through that.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, the other thing that we've heard a lot about is, you know, you talked earlier about being tired, but I know from my organization, and I've heard it from others, if I look at my leave balances, they keep going up because people aren't taking time off. And I think balancing that with, folks, you know, one of the questions we got while you were talking is HR professional saying, how do I convince my CEO that I need time off too? You know, and that's not just other people. And, you know, so this whole thing about, work-life balance right now seems really different when, as you pointed out, you don't have as many options available to you.
Well, and because we can't compartmentalize anyway. It's like work has come to your home now. So it's even harder and harder. This elusive work-life balance, and I kind of don't like that term because it's never been like been in balance. I call it work-life integration. Like,
I have to say, it was at your conference in Las Vegas when you had Martha Stewart, and she went off about what a stupid idea work-life balance was. Made my day.
It was hilarious. And, you know, from one type of personality to another, it resonated with me. But I do get it. And to the HR person out there, we're in a pickle now, especially for organizations. And I've been trying to preach this for a while. Organizations who, and I'm going to get to specifically the HR question, but we've waited until December. And so you can't let everyone go at one time. And so this is a classic example where the organizations who weren't along the way forcing people to take some of their time now find themselves where people say, I have this leave bank. And especially in those organizations where it's use it or lose it, they're now saying, I want to take the month of December off or 2 weeks in December. And you're like, yeah, but we have clients, we have services. We can't just, everyone can't leave at one time. And that creates tension. Nothing you can do about being in December of 2020, but there's a lot you can do in January of 2021. And that is start planning it. I've actually seen some organizations require that people take a percentage every quarter of their time. I hate those sorts of rigid policies, but I understand why that's so, because people, you know, sort of hoard that time, and then you get to the end of the year and then all the hoarders then want to let it go. So that's one suggestion. For the HR person in particular, this question comes up on nearly every call that I've been on. You probably could not afford you didn't have the luxury of taking the time off. In March, April, May, June, this is when this thing was in full, you know, and HR people were working 60, 70 hours a week. There was just no time to do it. Probably should have tried to sneak it during the summer, because that's when, you know, weather was warmer and the disease numbers went, the infection rates went down, da, 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 da. But now here you are, we're back in the swing of it. And this is a tough time because business leaders are relying very heavily on HR people to help them navigate, HR professionals navigate. As I said, 2021 is upon us. So a lot of what has to happen come January 1, everything from open enrollment to, you know, leave policies and all of that have to be done right now. So December is a tough month to try to, you know, check out as an HR person. The only thing that we're suggesting is for people who do work in a physical workplace that you try to take short days or work in the office 3 days a week and take two. You have to get your, you know, you got to take care of yourself because you can't help anyone else. It's the old rule about the flight attendants where, you know, they say, if you're flying with someone, a dependent, you know, put the vest on yourself first because you can't help the other person if you're not taken care of. So be a little selfish. And I don't know what to say in HR departments of one, because it's all on you. Just survive it. That's the only thing I can tell you. And then really plan in January after you get this thing up and running. That is, get your business think ahead so that you can then maybe take a New Year's break as opposed to a Christmas or end of the year break.
Yeah. Yeah. And you mentioned earlier, Johnny, that, you know, it's even difficult to listen to scientists because you can find scientists who are on both sides of the issue. And so one of the questions that we received was, you know, how do you know, staff feel so confused, they've got all of this conflicting information coming at them, and what role can we play in trying to provide clarity there? I know at our organization, what we've started doing is our medical director, you know, gives up COVID updates occasionally, you know, but, you know, I'm sure not everybody has that luxury, you know, so what other thoughts do you have?
No, because I don't have a medical director on my staff. But no, seriously, what we have done, and this is the question I've been asked a lot. So you have to decide who you're going to follow. And so some were following the World Health Organization. Some were saying, no, I'm going to follow the CDC. And then there was a debate over the federal CDC and then the state equivalents of the CDC. But we have taken a line in the sand and said it's going to be the CDC. Now, it's funny, and I'm kind of glib when people say this. They're like, we're going to listen to the scientist. Well, even when you decide there's a scientist you agree with, you only agree with that person until you don't. So, you know, I tell you where that classically happened, and I think this will resonate with you all. So we said, we're going to follow the CDC, period. And that's what the CDC director says is what we are going to follow in terms of our policies, practices, et cetera. And it was great until in August, the CDC director said, your kids should go back to school. The safest place for your kids to be, K through 12, is in school on balance. Oh my God, all of my employees who totally were happy with the CDC, they agreed with the scientists until they didn't. And that's where you really, as leaders can't waver. You've got to say, listen. And so what does that mean when an employee, it's easy when you're in a district where the district is shut down. Okay, that person has kids at home and you've got to take care of them and that's it, notwithstanding what the CDC says. But what if the CDC says kids should go back to school and your district is open and you don't want to, and you're making a choice to keep your kid at home? Do I, as an employer, have to accommodate that anymore? And that's where, again, you go back to whatever you are, be it. And you've got to be consistent, because if you go back and forth, again, you can't say, I'm going to believe in the scientists until either you don't agree with them or you never agreed with them. And that's something that I would caution you all against. You've got to take positions and stick to it, because your employees are going to judge you by what you do, not what you say.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, can we change topics a little bit? As fascinating as COVID is, you know, you talked a little bit at the beginning about diversity, equity, and inclusion. And you commented on two really important aspects of it, which we've gotten a lot of questions about. One is related to, you know, kind of the, hold on 1 second. One is related to
the battery died, right, Chuck?
Batteries died, yes. One is related to kind of, you know, kind of generational differences. And, you know, we saw somebody in the chat talk about the fact that they have employees ranging in age from the early 20s to the 75. And how do you create an inclusive workforce with so many different generations? Maybe we could start there.
Yeah, I talked about this multi-generational workforce problem. Let me tell you, I think the only way, so you can train forever, and I'm not suggesting that we shouldn't train, but we've had sexual harassment training around for three decades, right, or longer, and training alone isn't going to solve it. In fact, training with a whole bunch of other things won't solve for it. What I think the, and I'm talking more and more about this, I'm gonna throw this phrase that you're gonna hear, you heard it from Johnny Taylor, because I'm writing about it a lot. We have an empathy deficit in this country. And that is the none of us wanna walk in the other person's shoes. So the 20-year-old doesn't want to appreciate the issues that are impacting or the experience of the workplace of the 75-year-old. And vice versa. And so until we build from a cultural standpoint, build that empathy muscle and exercise it, it has atrophied for sure in all of our society, but in particular in the workplace, we've built this entire generation around individualization, have it your way, you know, get what you want. And you never think about how that impacts other people. And as a result, the clashes in the workplace, be it on race, be it on gender, age, whatever, it's because no one for a second wants to understand or try to understand how the other person experiences life and work. So as a real practical solution, sure, you're gonna do your training, your sexual harassment training and your DEI training and all of that good stuff. But I think at its core, you've gotta build up your workforce's ability to be more empathetic. That's how you're going to solve for these generational or any other set of differences. Short of that, you're going to find yourself with the natural conflict in the workplace. And what that means, by the way, is to the extent people are just not empathetic or won't pretend to be empathetic in the workplace, they shouldn't work in your culture, period. That's just the way it should be. And you've got to hold real strong to that. So that's the fix to it, the secret answer. Is sure you can train your way out of a box, but you're not going to solve for the things that really impact the workplace today through pure training.
And you know, the other thing I think many of us are, this kind of there's been a spotlight put on diversity, equity, and inclusion issues, and I know our organization, many others, have renewed efforts. What do you think is the most important kind of thing organizations can do to make sure these are sustained, that it's more than just a statement, that it actually leads to change and is sustainable in an organization?
Yeah, in fact, I'm pretty rough on the organizations, and we're following them, who rushed out after the senseless death of George Floyd to, and its murder, frankly, to issue platitude-filled statements and write checks to nonprofits. I mean, as someone in the nonprofit space, we take it. But, and they, you know, I loved it when they said, I hired a diversity trainer and the person came in and they did 3 sessions and we're done. You know, like, no, that's not how this works. It requires a transformation initiative. And it takes time to win people's hearts and their minds and to change learned behavior. And all of us, you know, when we talk about unconscious bias, we all have them. Black people have them, white people have them, men have them, women have them. So we all suffer from it. And so it's part of the human condition, right? So what I think all of us as leaders have to do is position things as not one group's or one group with a specific characteristic, it's their fault, it's all of our opportunity. And we all have to see that we bring our own biases, some conscious and some unconscious, into the workplace and try to address them. That takes time. Just think about, I know in about 30 days, I'm gonna take one more of those beginning of the year, end of the year commitments to work out. And it's gonna last exactly 2 weeks. And somebody's gonna make a lot of money because I'm gonna go buy all of this foolishness to put in my house and I won't use it again. Well, it's that, and I'm being a little, you know, tongue in cheek about it, but that really is the problem, is so many people stepped up when there was this big reckoning on race in the country in the middle of the year. And then you can already see it starting to fall off. We as leaders have to say, this is good for business. America is both browning and graying at once. So if you think this is something you're gonna do to just get past the moment, the workforce of the future is more brown than not. It's a majority minority country. K through 12 public schools are majority minority already. And so you don't have to guess whether or not the workforce is going to be more diverse. It is. And our opportunity is to make sure that these folks get opportunities, diverse workforces get them, and that once you get them into your workplace, that we really focus on inclusion. It's not enough to solve for the diversity part, because diversity is hard, inclusion is much harder. I don't tell any of you on the phone, but managing diverse populations is far more difficult than managing a homogenous group of people who think alike, experience alike, et cetera. So that's going to be what we've got to do, is focus on inclusion even more. And I don't want this to get anyone upset, but more and more, inclusion is the driver over diversity.
Well, you know, we had some questions about that. So would you mind, you know, maybe elaborating on that a little bit more? What does talent management look like from an inclusion lens, and what are the kind of things organizations need to be doing?
So I'm gonna say this because this is a favorite question of mine, and it comes in different flavors. But so in the past, and I think even now, we largely, when we say we want the right talent, we focus almost exclusively on technical competency. And what we totally have missed in most organizations is cultural alignment. So there are two prongs to this. All of us have hired the person who's really, really good, but is a disaster in our workplace. And sometimes they're not just troublemakers, they're just not aligned. You see the world one way, I see it the other way, and there's this constant battle. I'll give you an example. I told a group, our employees, that SHRM was nonpartisan. We weren't bipartisan, we were nonpartisan, full stop. And so I had some employees who really took issue with that, because they said, well, when that party or that person is just wrong, how and why won't you come out and say that? I said, because I just won't get into partisanship. There's no win for us. And I think our country has no shortage of that already. So there were people who said, you know, this culture isn't for me. And I said, you're right, because we are about policy, not politics. And I won't be dragged into that hole with you. And we're not good or bad, we're just SHRM, right? And you've got to figure out what you are. And what that means is, in the recruitment process, talent acquisition people, we so often want to get the person who checks all of the right boxes. They have this many years of experience, they graduated from this school, they've worked at this industry, nonprofit versus for-profit, da-da-da. And you get this technically perfect person, but they're not culturally aligned. And I got to tell you, and I believe my colleagues here on the phone would agree, every day I'd take someone who I need to train up a little bit on the technical side for someone who's culturally aligned. And now I want to give one disclaimer. Cultural alignment has in the past been used as cultural fit. And sometimes fit has been used to exclude diverse candidates. So I'm not suggesting that, but I am saying that all of us would do ourselves well to spend some time sitting down as an ELT, your executive team, and saying, this is who we are. This is what we want the workplace to be. And no matter how brilliant a person is as a candidate, if they don't qualify on both, you know, technical competency and cultural alignment, we don't hire them, period. You're going to save yourself a headache. You're going to save yourself the loss of some good employees who say, I'm over this place, if you do that.
Well, that's great. So, you know, Johnny, we've been in the habit of trying to end at 5 minutes before the hour. So I'm just wondering, any final thoughts from you as we wrap up?
Well, I started with on it real quickly. One, you got to take care of yourself, leaders. Whether you're the CEO, the CHRO, the CDO, whatever you are, you've got to figure out how to take care of yourself. And this thing around the empathy deficit, it's real. It's going to solve so many of your problems as an organization if you just make yourself think, if we can just raise it 5-10 degrees, how differently and how much more smoothly your workplace will be. Because if you think you're going to train people out of this mindset, if their mindset isn't right and they're not concerned about the person sitting next to them, you're just not going to have the success that you want to see from a workforce standpoint. But thank you all. Happy holidays. Thank you for inviting me. And I look forward to seeing you. I think it's next year, right? In person.
At NatCon in May 2021, we'll have another opportunity to hear from you, and just so value your perspective and your time. Thank you so much for being with us, and thank you to all the attendees.